It's my privilege to share this time with you and to present what I think is a very critical subject, so critical that I think it's irresponsible to send a missionary anywhere in the world today without some basic instruction in this area. I'm glad that it's coming out of the closet into respectability. If I had time, I could tell you about some of the ways in which that's happening. There's an openness to talking about this subject across the front of the church that was not true even 10 years ago, and we can be grateful for that. If you have the notes in your notebook, I discover that it's an old outline, and I'll not be following the outline you have there for the most part, so you probably will want to simply get some notepaper to follow. This area... There is a diagram there, which we'll come to later on, and that will be helpful to you at the time. The Free Church is not the only church that is beginning to see this area as a vital area. I'm grateful for the reports that I heard even this morning about the way the ministry is impacting the church. I can tell you that I know of Free Church pastors who have, or at least a pastor who has been through deliverance himself, and of others who are helping their people in this area. Within the last few months, we have had two TEDS graduates go through deliverance with us, and I wish they were here to tell you their own story. We'll come to some of the practical things a little bit later. Let me begin with a few comments about a basic principle, and I call it the principle of balance. The premise is that evil is always the perversion of a good, that God made things good. His world was a perfect world. There was no sin in it. There was no suffering in it. There was no catastrophe in it. God didn't create the world flawed. He created it perfect. And we'll come to the process by which it got flawed. But the principle of balance is that, as I stated for a philosophy, the Christian life is the exciting process of trying to keep your balance. This is based on this premise that while good is the way God made the world, Satan is out here on all sides of the good, perverting it, trying to create evil. So evil is the perversion of a good. And it's not only bad out here, but it's bad out here. Satan gives us the impression that evil is on one side and good is on the other, that these are polar opposites. The fact is that good is in the middle and evil is on both sides. And so he will get us to overreact to a problem on one side, swing clear over to the other side, and create a new evil. You don't have, you can examine that with anything in your life. I invite you to try to apply that even to the concepts of love, for example, which pushed one way becomes a doting tolerance of everything and a refusal to discipline children and so on, which is no longer love, or a withholding of love on the other side. And so many, even many of you probably have suffered from the withholding of love by parents and by others. And somewhere we've lost the truth that comes at the center of it. In relation to the topic that we're talking about today, it is that Satan always sends his errors in polar pairs. And on the subject of demons, the polar pairs are a disbelief in them, to simply say they don't exist. And I was at a conference this last week where a Christian anthropologist was seriously proposing to us that we adopt a totally secular view of trying to explain the phenomenon of demon activity, simply because we live in a technological society where you just can't believe in that kind of spirit activity anymore. On the other hand, there is a belief that becomes so pervasive that you just see demons everywhere, and you just live your life almost as though they were in control of the world and not God. C.S. Lewis in Screwtape Letters says about this, there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils, he calls them, the demons. One is to disbelieve in their existence. The other is to believe and to feel an excessive and unhealthy interest in them. They themselves are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. So we want to avoid falling into either of those extremes. And we're not going to end up saying that behind every problem is a demon and you solve human problems by casting out demons. But I think we will have to end up seeing that the demonic activity in the world is far more pervasive than most of us have realized. Now, there's more that could be said about that, but we'll leave the philosophy of balance and press on because we have lots of things that we'd like to cover. Unfortunately, missionaries have gone to the field without preparation in this area. I was a missionary in Sierra Leone, West Africa, back in the 50s, and I looked at the world out there through typical Western tourist eyes. I stood on the hill of Sambaya Bandugu, an interior village where we'd walk 25 miles to reach it, looked down at the village where the devil, the demon, they were saying the devil was dancing with the big ceremonial headdress and all of this, and the women were told if they came out of the house, their noses would fall off, and it was a very power-oriented thing, and yet, as far as I was concerned, I was looking at it like a tourist. Now, I had a degree in biblical literature from a Christian college and a degree in theology from a theological seminary, but I still was not looking at it theologically in any sense. I am appalled at what I didn't know and what I didn't believe when I was a missionary in Africa. Let me read you an account written by concerning a missionary. It says, his eyes were glassy, his clothes ragged, his hair matted. He was desperate. I'm going to kill this animal, he repeated three times. I thought he was talking about me. The lady of the house where we were gave us all some strong coffee, but he didn't want it. Suddenly he fell on the floor, knocking the dishes off the table. We dragged him out of the house, and he looked up at me and said, have mercy on me. Then I recognized his problem. He was demon-possessed. These spells began after he stopped attending an evangelical church and turned to Spiritism. I remembered the words of Jesus, behold, I give you authority over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall hurt you. I felt I should rebuke the demon in the name of Jesus, but what if nothing happened? All the people gathered would ridicule me. I slipped behind another man and watched as the man finally got up and started down the street being held by two men. Abruptly, he threw them off and started running. He was tackled and they had to bind him until he was over the spell. There I was, a defeated missionary in the interior of Brazil, ready to pack up and go home. When face to face with the enemy, I was afraid. Who had told me how to deal with demons? Where was the discernment to recognize the demons? Perhaps this failing was due to inadequate teaching. No perhaps about it, it undoubtedly was. Lord, I prayed, I'll not run again. Help me to discern evil spirits and give me faith to believe your power to overcome them. We could repeat many, many such stories about missionaries coming face to face with demonic activity and not knowing what to do with it. And that's a tragedy, that we are running from the devil instead of the devil running from us, as the scriptures tell us should be the case. The fact is that missionaries have been one of the most secularizing forces in the world. This is not my judgment. This is the judgment of Leslie Newbigin and many others who first made the statement, many others who have looked at the international scene. Did you get the impact of that statement? Missionaries, Christian missionaries, have been one of the most secularizing forces in the world. Now, how is that? Well, it happens this way. We go almost without exception, to people who, when they look at life, that this continuum represents life in all of its aspects, will explain almost everything that happens on this continuum by reference to the supernatural. We say they ascribe a maximum of causation to the supernatural. So whatever they see happening down here, they explain by reference to spirit activity. Because we've come through the scientific and technological revolution, we know that most of what we see happening doesn't happen because of supernatural activity. It does happen by what we call natural forces. So we say to them, for example, look, it isn't the spirits that make your crops grow or not grow. Agriculture depends on your knowledge of the laws of scientific agriculture. And if you can fertilize the soil properly and you can get hybrid seed and you can use fungicides and pesticides, you can grow better crops because that's scientific and not religious. And it isn't the spirits who are unhappy when there's an eclipse. We can explain that to you scientifically, and we can predict it 1,000 years in advance down to the minute, because that's scientific and not religious. And these problems that you see are simply mental illness. They're not demons. And we lop off all of these areas of life, and we end up with one area here that we call religion, and the rest of it is science. I submit to you that that is a fallacious explanation of the world, but that's the world, the explanation of the world that you and I have been taught in almost all of our schooling, whether it be public education or Christian education. And we'll be taking a look shortly at why that's wrong. Let me just give you a little advance explanation, because the question could easily be asked, what should you say about agriculture, for example, that would put it into a truly Christian context? Well, I think you should say that there is a law in this universe that because this is a God-created world, this supernatural realm up here is not some disorganized group of spirit beings, but it is a sovereign God who is the creator and the sustainer of all things. And he's still in control of things. And the law is that if we do things in life God's way, then we get God's results. If we do them our way, then we get our results. That's true in the spiritual realm, but it's also true in the material realm, the realm we call the realm of science. And so what happens here is that we should say to these people, God has made the world good. And he has put the things in the world that if we put together in the right way, then we get God's good result. If we don't understand the way God has made the world, and we don't do it his way, then we're not going to get his good results. So science, what we call science, is simply our correct observation of the way God has made the world. So what we do when we practice so-called scientific agriculture is really to cooperate with God, but it's still God who makes the crops grow. No scientist makes any crop grow. You can't create or destroy life in the ultimate sense. Only God can do that. And it is indeed a supernatural activity. And the reason we can predict the eclipse 1,000 years in advance, and the reason we can explain it, is because we have simply discovered the way God has made the world, and we're saying about it what's true about it, and the fact that it's regular and predictable is a reflection of the sovereign God, not of some disorganized world of spirits that do things in haphazard sorts of ways. And we need to get a really Christian view of the world rather than this false view of the world. Well, the problem then is that we as missionaries have not been so trained, and as a result, we have not really presented a Christian worldview to the people to whom we go. So we want to take a look at this thing we call worldview. Missionaries relate to the people to whom they go in five different ways. They work with them, and we do that reasonably well. That's fairly easy to identify with people at the level of work. We play with them. We don't do that nearly as well. We tend to play with other missionaries rather than with the nationals with whom we work and minister. We organize with them. That presents all kinds of problems because our concepts of organization are often very different than their concepts. But these are elements of identification, and that we can at least understand and work with. We believe with them. That is, we come to the point where we understand how they got from where they are today from where they started. They got to where they are today from where they started. But the most difficult thing we have to do is to kin with them. And kinning is a relatively new term, I think. But it has to do with what happens in the times of crisis in life. Where do you turn to make sure that you cover the essential bases when illness and death and other catastrophes come? And the fact is that we very seldom develop a relationship with the nationals with whom we work, particularly if those people are animistic in their basic belief system, to the point that they come to us for help at the time of catastrophe, or where we go to them for help at that time. And what happens in most places is that while they have a theoretical Christian theology about those things, they still go back to the animistic roots. They still go back and offer the right sacrifices. They go through the family ceremonies. They do the things that they think they need to do to cover it safely. And until we can get to the point where we have really addressed that issue, we haven't really identified with the people, and we haven't really communicated the gospel to them as that gospel ought to be communicated. What is this thing called worldview? When you go into a new society, whether that society, wherever it may be in the world, whether it's east or west, or north or south, you come first into this outer ring that gives you the observable behavior of the people, allows you to see the objects they're using. You don't have to be in a new society very long to realize that you're in a foreign situation. Even going to England, the language immediately tells you that you're a little bit foreign, and you go to restaurants and other places, and you know that things are a little different. When we landed in Africa, you know, it was culture shock right off the bat from our suitcases going off on the heads of the porters instead of in their hands or on a truck of some kind, and all of the other things that went from there on. So that we identify with very quickly, and we tend to respond to it. Behind that level are the institutions of the culture. Now, I don't mean buildings or orphanages or hospitals. I mean the institution of the family, the institution of society, of government, of education, and so on, the way they handle these things. And as you understand the institution, then you understand the behavior better. For example, if this would happen to be a matrilineal society, where they count descent through the mother's line, you would see some strange things happening out here in relation to family behavior that you simply would be at a loss to understand. For example, in that kind of a society, you would find the man we would call a maternal uncle being responsible for the discipline and the education of the children in the family, not the biological father. The biological father would relate to his own children like we would expect an uncle to relate. Now, why is that? Well, if you understand the institution of matrilineal descent, then you would understand that, because in matrilineal descent, they practice what is called exogamous marriage, which means you cannot marry within your own clan. You have to marry somebody from another clan. And in this case, the wife comes from one clan, the husband from another clan, and the children belong to the mother's clan. it's matrilineal descent. The descent is counted through the mother's line. So the father is sort of an outsider who's been brought into this family, but he can't teach his children because he doesn't know the lore of the right clan. So it has to be somebody from the mother's clan who does the teaching, and that's the mother's brother. So he's the one who trains them in the clan that he's a member of and that they're going to be members of so that they'll have the right information and can be good clan members the rest of the way down through their lives. Well, if you didn't understand that, you would make some wrong interpretations of what was going on out here, and furthermore, you would have some significant problems in communicating the concept of God our Father. Who are you going to talk about? The uncle who disciplines and trains them, or the one who bore them biologically? Now, that's why you need to study anthropology, and if you've not studied anthropology, you ought to at least get a hold of a good anthropology book and read it, because that's where you learn about those kinds of relationships within culture. But we're not really to worldview yet, because behind the institutions are values. And values can also vary tremendously from culture to culture. We tend to assume that values have a theistic base, that they derive from God or from a belief in the supernatural. In many societies, values have little to do with a concept of God or no relation to it, because they really don't have a functional concept of God. They will relate rather to a balance, a maintaining a balance in the order of nature, and particularly between the spirits in nature. And they think that various kinds of behavior will upset that balance, so it, you know, you're not allowed to comb your hair during a thunderstorm, or you're not allowed to comb your hair out in the bush during the day, or whatever, that don't make any sense to us, but they would be very serious offenses to them because that's the way they've defined values. We had an inversion of values with our Africans because they always thought the missionaries looked great when they came back after furlough all fattened up. They thought fat was good and thin was bad, and we tend to think of it the other way around. Now, those are, to some extent, simply cultural values, but we need to understand the values. Values stem, however, from this thing we call worldview, and everything out here really has its root in this basic belief system about the world of which we're a part. The worldview is the way you explain what is and the way you derive values based on your belief of what is. So we say that worldview gives us explanatory concepts and normative concepts that explains reality and then derives value based on it. Actually, there are many different definitions of worldview and functions of worldview, but let me just give you a basic definition. Worldview is the central systematization, and a key word there is systematization, because it's not a hodgepodge of beliefs, but it's a systematizing of the conceptions of reality. What is really real? What am I seeing is real, and what is real, and how do I explain it? To not be able to explain your world is very unsettling and creates a great amount of fear, and therefore everybody develops some method of explanation. So worldview is the central systematization of the conception of reality to which members of a culture assent, and this will tend to be a shared belief system, largely unconsciously. That's an extremely important concept, and if I were writing the definition, I'd leave the parenthesis off because I think it's almost essential to the definition that you don't know what your worldview is. You think you do, but the way you find out a worldview is not by asking a person what it is. We'll speak about that in a moment. And from which stems their value system. So here is this conception of reality that has been systematized, which is held largely unconsciously because you just grow up with it. It's just absorbed from the world in which you live and from which stems the value system. Let me just say a word about the largely unconsciously. The fact is that the subject we're talking about is a very difficult subject because for you and me, spirits are simply not very real. They're theoretically real, but not practically real. They're not functional in our everyday life. I had a professor at college who used to say, a person may not live what he professes, but he will always live what he believes. Do you identify with that? Not living what you profess, but living what you believe. What you believe is your value system. Now, I say that spirits aren't very real to us. Let me ask you a question. When do you control your emotions better? When important persons are present that you want to impress, or when the Holy Spirit is present? When do you modify any of your conduct more? When you are in the presence of important people like the President of the United States or the Queen of England, or when you're in the presence of God? I used to ask the students at the Bible college where I was, if you're having a bull session in the dorm, when are you restrained from allowing it to degenerate to unwholesome levels? When the dean's listening at the door, or when God is listening? The fact is that we're much more humanistic than we want to admit, that we tend to adjust our lives to human values and to human beings more than we do to spirits. God is spirit. The Holy Spirit is spirit, but they're simply not functional parts of our reality system to the point that we really adjust our lives based on their presence. You will be going, for the most part, to people to whom that is the other way around, where spirits are very, very functional in their value system, and they will get much more angry over a curse that's put on them than something you may do to them at the physical level. The spirit world is a very real world, and the problem is that we don't really know what our worldview is. We enunciate our good theologies, but when it comes to everyday life, that's not really the level at which we live. We live at a humanistic, secular level. If you go out to raise money for missions, you're speaking in a church, you will almost always get more money if you use humanistic motivations than if you use spiritual motivations. Some of you have been around long enough to know that already. People will give you more money to feed starving children and refugees and to offer medical service to lepers and to diseased people than they will to preach the gospel, but to declare the glory of God. We're not spiritually oriented people. We're materially and humanistically oriented. And I'm not saying that we shouldn't have humanistic values. We should respond to humanistic values, but we ought to be responding more positively and more forcefully to spiritual values. This is our problem with worldview, that right at the center of our belief system, we are really conformed to the world around us more than we want to acknowledge that we are. And until we can change that, we're going to have great difficulties. This problem with worldview manifests itself in a number of different ways. One of them looks something like this. We have this continuum here running from animism or spiritism at one end, where everything is explained by reference to spirits, to materialism, secularism at the other end, where nothing is explained by reference to spirit activity. The church ought to be right here in the middle of this continuum. Christianity is, in a sense, a materialistic religion. because it treats matter as the creation of God, and therefore not evil per se. We are not in a belief system that says matter is evil and spirit is good, nor are we in one which says that matter is ultimate and there is no spirit. We are in a belief system in Christianity which says this whole world is the creation of God. He created the material world, he created the world of spirits, and these two are interlinked in a very functional sort of way here at the center of this continuum. The problem is that we go almost without exception to people in other parts of the world who are coming from this end of the spectrum. And even if you're going to Western Europe or to a Muslim country where they may have a form of monotheism, you will find a majority of the people still operating on a basically animistic worldview. I just spent several days in France in May instructing a group of missionaries there because they had written to the mission board saying, help, 50 to 60% of our converts are coming out of open occult practices. And sorcery and witchcraft and magical healing and all of these kinds of things are rampant. There are more practitioners of the occult arts in France than there are medical doctors. And this is a Western, sophisticated, secular Europe, but shot through with the occult. So don't assume that because you're going to that kind of a society, you're not going to meet this. We're meeting it increasingly here in the United States. Well, we go there and we preach the gospel to these people, and because our worldview is not correct, we don't speak theologically or practically to this area of life that involves dealing with magic and sorcery and witchcraft and all of that. And we end up with a church that looks something like this instead of like this. There are lots of elements of Christianity in it, but there still is the practice of the old pagan ways. Current example of that was an election for bishop that was being conducted in an East African country. And one of the candidates for bishop in this good Western denominational mission church went to one of these occult practitioners to get a charm to enhance his chances of being elected bishop in the Christian church. Now, we call that syncretism. That's the mixing of the old and the new. In Nairobi, Kenya, they had a lawsuit that went to the Supreme Court within this last year over where a prominent attorney should be buried. His wife, who came from a different tribe, and they were thoroughly westernized people who had lived in Nairobi all their lives, and she was simply going to have him buried in a cemetery in Nairobi. The tribal leaders from his tribe came and said, he's got to be buried in tribal land, or we'll have no end of trouble with evil spirits. That went to the Supreme Court, and they subpoenaed Christian leaders who confirmed the fact that if he weren't buried in tribal land, that they would have trouble with evil spirits. There was no concept of the power of Christ to disarm the power of the evil spirits. Now, that's syncretism. The real problem, however, is that we are also syncretistic, only we're syncretistic from this end of the spectrum. We still have this much of secularism and materialism in our belief system that we don't recognize as such. And this end of the spectrum is just, that's just not part of our thinking. That's certainly not part of our experience. And so we get two kinds of syncretism meeting, the syncretism of the missionary and the syncretism of the animist. And it's no wonder that these problems are rampant on the mission field today. I would suggest to you that if you're not aware of this, that probably the biggest problem you'll face there will be this problem of syncretism. This is true in most areas of the world. Now, we need also to recognize that you get into a cult from either end of the spectrum. You certainly get into it here because their spirit is everything. But this creates a vacuum into which some kind of spiritual activity is going to come. And so you'll find in the United States today things like the Forum. It used to be called the Earhart Seminar Training, which purports to train businessmen or just average Americans how to use their mental capacities to achieve success. The only problem is they start out by saying this is not religious. Some people say this is a cult. That's ridiculous. We have nothing to do with God, nothing to do with Jesus Christ. And to prove that, they write God and Jesus Christ on the chalkboard and have everybody in the seminar come up and erase it as a symbol of erasing God and Jesus Christ out of their minds, because this is something they're going to do for themselves. One young man had been in that not long, and he called me and he said, "I discovered I'm having out-of-the-body experiences. How do I handle this?" And he discovered that he was into the occult. A Baptist minister called me just a matter of a few weeks ago saying, help. A lady from my church went to a New Age meeting. The New Age movement basically says the same thing. This is the tapping of the latent powers of the mind. There's nothing supernatural about it. It's simply learning to use your own mental capacities. And she came back demonized, and we've been working with her for a month. She hasn't eaten for a month, and we don't know what to do with her. It's a longer story than that. They got into it from this end of the spectrum, from what purported to be purely material. Parapsychology does the same thing, and other things. They give it scientific names. They call it something other than spirit, but all it is an opening into the occult. So the problem of worldview is really fundamental to what we're doing. Now we want to take a look at some worldviews and see what they look like. Let's look first at this worldview that we've been calling animism. There's a very simplistic diagram, and I apologize, but it will give you the idea. Animists basically believe that reality is all of one piece. There's no such thing as animal, vegetable, and mineral for the animist in terms of qualitative difference. Everything is permeated by spirit power. If I turn out to be a good teacher today, it would, to the animist, be as much a function of this microphone, which obviously has power that can take my voice and amplify it, and can make it come out on that tape recorder down there. There's got to be some great power at work there. It might be that this podium has particularly good spirit power, and that's being transferred to me, and therefore I become a good teacher. Everything is permeated by the same power. That power is controllable. There are ways, by offering the right sacrifices, going through the right ceremonies, that I can transfer power from one thing to another. That's why I carry good luck charms, rabbit foot, and stuff like that, because that power can be transferred from one thing to another. So this is all of all one piece. And the spirit power is perceived as impersonal spiritual power. That's the kind of power that would be the what I've just been talking about, that resides mainly in things. But it's also in actual living spirits that may reside in nature, that may be ancestral in origin, that may be good or evil, all kinds of spirit activity. These spirits are constantly in touch with this world. They're not relegated to some spirit world, but they're very much a part of this whole world of which we are a part. There are certain people down here, technically called the shaman, or we use other terms like witch doctor and so on, but the technical term would be shaman, and they have a unique ability to go into the spirit world, to actually leave their bodies and in spirit travel in the spirit world, communicate with the spirits, get messages from them, get power from them, and they are the ones that people usually operate through in their relations to the spirit world. Though as far as everyday life is concerned, they're always interacting with the spirits. They're, because the spirits are simply everywhere, they simply permeate this life. Now that's a whole different cosmology. That's a whole different worldview than what you and I have. Furthermore, the person having the most spiritual power has nothing to do with the morality or the ethics of that person. He may be the most evil person by our standards, but he's considered powerful because of his ability to manipulate the spirit world and to get the power from the spirit world and transfer it down into this world in an effective way. So animism has to be understood, or you will simply make a lot of wrong judgments about what you're seeing out there. A typical Western worldview, and I suppose we should say a Western worldview of the Christian subculture, would look something like this. A supernatural realm, the realm of God, however God is defined by a given group of people. The realm of religion down here, the natural realm is over against the supernatural, the realm of science is over against the realm of religion. These two are largely mutually exclusive. They don't interact very much. There is relatively little that transpires that is caused by this realm but ends up happening in this realm. We assume that for any phenomena down here, there's a cause down here. One of the men at the consultation I attended this last week was proposing that it was only intellectually honest to assume that whatever we saw happening down here, no matter how we might have defined it in the past as demon activity, we had to assume that if we studied long enough, we would find a cause down here, that there simply is little, if any, cause-effect relationship between this realm and this realm. Therefore, we ask either-or kinds of questions. We say, is it supernatural or is it natural? Is it religious or is it scientific? Is it spiritual or is it psychological? As though these are mutually exclusive categories, and we can ask these either-or kinds of questions. We ask, is it demons or is it just the flesh? Again, assuming an exclusive division of these categories. Now, obviously, there are some people in the West who don't have this realm. A pure materialist, a pure rationalist doesn't have a supernatural realm at all. This is all we have at all. But even in the Christian subculture within the West, this is basically the worldview. It's a two-tiered worldview that looks like this. Now, I say, I submit to you that that's a fallacious worldview and that we need to take a look at what I call a biblical worldview. Now,